Okay, now the recording starts. Okay, girls, first we'll see what is digital logic. So all those things we are going to start from the history. Okay, so when it has started. So if you take the history of digital computers, it is digital is nothing but it is related with the computer. Okay, now you can see there are if you take any field, everywhere this is computers are there. Its technology is adopted everywhere. So you can't say a particular field where it is not used. Okay, everywhere you have the, even in your mobile you have the computer, yes or no? So there operating system is there in your mobile. You can do, you can see, you can even, you can do programming with your mobile also. So there is no place where it is not at all used. Okay, so from bank to the devices used in our home, right? In for bank transactions, you depend now EB. When you want to pay EB, you go for a website and you do transactions, etc. When you use mobile, then you use washing machines. In washing machines, we have computer, that is microprocessor we have, which you call it as a motherboard. We have in our washing machine, we have microprocessor where you can set the program, yes or no? So if you want to do, say for example, washing for 10 minutes, then draining, then spinning. So all those things you can set. It is a programming. So there also we use computer. Then in our kitchen, cookware. Even now in the induction stove, we have that options of setting the how many whistle the cooker has to do, or you can set timings. A particular heat can be there, remain there for 10 minutes like that. You can set. What the difference is, you cannot code like C++. You cannot do run the program, but you can a very, very restricted instructions. You can use that. So there again, microprocessor are there. Then you have oven, you have fridge. Everywhere you can see a small microprocessor is there, which will do a defined job, not the whole thing. It cannot do a fridge, cannot run a washing machine. A washing machine cannot do a function of a induction stove. But so for the particular applications, what are the things has to be done? Those things are programmed and those things are kept in that particular machines. So wherever you see in your home, you can find the application of computers everywhere. And this we call it as a microprocessor digital. Okay, everything is done through electronics, digital. So first we will see what it is. Okay, so the development of digital system can be discussed as starting from the abacus, then comes the Napier's device, then slide rule, all these devices. Then and there, the scientists, they have discovered and they will do some functions. And the next thing, say for example, Napier's device, then comes the slider rule, means it will do a little more function than the previous one. Then we have Pascal's calculating machines, then Pascal machine improvements were done by that scientist called Leibniz. So it is called Leibniz improved Pascal machines. Then we have punched card is once upon a time, I think to 20 or 30 years back, it will be used in big mills or companies where they will record the entry of the employees and when they go out, the timings, the enter time and exit time will be recorded. So for all those things, punched card is there. Then it is used for programming also. Okay, for giving instruction to the computers, the punched card were used. Nowadays, we don't have that, but all those things are present previously. So now what the computer now you have, it is an improvement of all those things. Then Charles Babbage engines, Hollerith machines, then digital computer, Mach 1 digital computer, then first electronics computer, then ENIAC, EDVAC, etc. then comes, see, the 14th point, integrated chip technology. Now the system is in a very small thing. You can have your iPad, you can have it in a laptop, all those things, that is because of this IC, that is integrated chip technology. Before that, they used transistors, vacuum tubes, which in which a computer occupies even a one big room. Okay, whereas now you can have your computer within your palm top, laptop, and that is because of the revolution in the integrated chip. Then with that integrated chip, the microprocessor built. So microprocessor will do many functions with the help of the small chips that we are going to see in due course in this class. Then comes a personal computer. Now whatever I have given, I just given a small idea how they will look. Okay, abacus. This I think many places, even nowadays, they are teaching this abacus to improve your numerical skill. So it will be like this. So here, once, this is for ones, tens, and so position of the thing, not only position, but it will be in terms of digits. Okay, ones, tens, hundreds, thousand, 10,000, and so on. Then Napier device. It is formed by John Napier, a Scottish mathematician, and he found it. He can calculate the products and quotients of large number could be using this. It can be obtained. So he can obtain the product. Say for example, 5 × 4 means what is the product? 20. Remainder will be 0. So that can be calculated using this. He used this machine to calculate the product and their remainder. Then slider rule. It look like this, and it is what was invented in 17th century based on logarithm by this John Napier. Then Pascal calculating machines, it looks like this. Blaise Pascal, as a French mathematician, developed this device in 1642 CE. It do only addition and subtraction, no multiplication. Then comes the next improved version where it will do multiplication, division, and it can even find out the square root operation. So it's a improved version. Then we have this punch card. Punch card were first used around 1725 by Basley Boken and Jean Baptiste Falcon, and greatly improved by Joseph Marie Jacquard in 1801. It is, as I said, it is mainly initially it was used in companies for recording the time. Later it is used for data entry or programming in the computers. After the computer, coming of the computer, it is used for entering the programs. Then Charles Babbage, see how much big it is. This is a computer. He founded this, he is called the father of computer, Charles Babbage. So Charles Babbage, from 1792 to 1871, he made a machine called difference engine, later modified the device as analytical engine. It will do all the calculations. Then comes the first electronics computer called Atanasoff Berry computer, ABC. Dr. John Atanasoff and Clifford Berry, they developed the first electronic computer. It looks like this, and it is called ABC. It used vacuum tubes for storage, arithmetic and logic functions. If you see this, all these are electronic device where you have the vacuum tubes, etc., and transistors. Okay. So the vacuum tube, one vacuum tube, will be a bigger one, like equal to a finger. So if you have so many things, imagine how much big the system will be. So special purpose used to solve the simultaneous equations. It could perform 500 addition or 350 multiplication in 1 second. That was the capacity of this. But now it is millions and millions of additions and subtractions and many things simultaneously. Nowadays the computers can do a lot of calculations within a second. Then electronic numerical integrator and calculator, ENIAC. So here, this is developed by Professor Prosper Ecker and John Macleay. So it was produced in 1940 for US Army. Especially those days, the computer which are invented mainly used in telecommunication and armies. Okay, and it used 18,000 watts, 70,000 resistor. See how much parts, right? This VT is nothing but vacuum tubes, that much vacuum tubes. This one thing is a computer. It used this much of vacuum tubes, 70,000 resistor, and 10,000 capacitor, and 60,000 switches. Capacitors are mainly used for storing the charge, okay, the charge which is required for running this computer. Then it occupies this much of space, perform 300 multiplication, and second fastest machine. Then ENIAC was considered a significant development because the speed was first experienced with ENIAC. Then EDVAC, that is Electronic Discrete Variable Automatic Computers. This is the first electronic stored program computer. Electronics computer developed in 49. EDVAC different from ENIAC, and the use of binary and the electronic operators. It is mainly there comes the starting using of binary numbers. What do you mean by binary numbers? So far
Zero
you,
and one.
yes. So far you have used decimal numbers. That's what you get used to that. So far up to 12th standard we use to know decimal numbers 0 to 10. Okay, then 0 to 9 I can say. Then after that it comes the repeated number of 0 to 9. So 10 means 1, 0, which is already occurring in 0 to 9. Then 10, 11, and so on. And 19, again 20 means it is already occurring in 0 to 9, that is 2 and 0. So this is what so far we have seen decimal number. That is why we call it as a base 10. Okay, because 0 to 9 it is base 10. Now here what introduced the binary concept, which is nothing but by the name binary itself means 0 and 1. So it is two numbers, only two numbers will be there. Even all the big decimal numbers can be represented with a binary representation. Just by saying 0 and 1, 0 and 1, you can represent the decimal numbers. So that we are, that also how it can be represented, we are going to study in due course. Okay, so this is our first electronic stored program computer, and it used binary and electronic arithmetic operators. Internal storage of instructions were written in digital form. That comes the actually the programming, and we call it as the instructions that will be stored in the computer. So there comes the internal storage itself. Then electronics delay storage, that is EDSAC. It was developed by scientists headed by Professor Maury Willis, and here it is additional operation was accomplished in 1500 microseconds. It is much faster than the previous one, and multi-seconds operator in 4000 microseconds. Then comes the UNIVAC. Most probably it comes around 1954. This computer comes. You should have seen in olden scientists science fiction stories where you can see a computer of this type. Okay, so second commercial computer produced in the United States. That is commercial means the first computer, the second computer which was built and for sales outside. Before that it was used in army and all, but now for personal use now they have started built like this. So made by the inventors of ENIAC, and the machine was simply known as the UNIVAC. Then comes the microprocessor. With the development of the microprocessor comes the great revolution in the micro, that is in the computers. So first microprocessor chip, it was developed by Intel Corporation. Intel is a company, Intel Corporation, in 1969, and the name of the chip is given a name as Intel 4004. It performs very few instructions and very small amount of data only it can hold. Then comes in 71, Intel 8008 microprocessor was developed, and slowly now we have a very large voluminous of data. It can be stored, and then millions of instructions a microprocessor can now execute. So this is a starting point of the personal computer. With this only, the computer which now we have started reducing in its started reducing in its size and increased in its efficiency. The first generation vacuum tubes. So again, what we are seeing is the old computers. What are the devices they have used? This the vacuum tubes look like this. See the vacuum tube. So if this much, this in the previous one, we have seen 16,000 vacuum tubes, 16 or 18,000 vacuum tubes. If one is having this much size, imagine how much space it might have occupied. Okay, so then second generation, next after the vacuum tubes come the transistor. See, it will be like this. Even in your physics class, many of you might have taken physics. In physics lab, you should have seen transistors of this type. Okay, of course, it is smaller than the vacuum tubes, but still it is bigger only. Okay, so this is the next advantage. Then comes IC, third generation, integrated circuits. Initially, it was it's a transistor like IC, but then using this, this was built. I'll show you the actual integrated chip. So from 65 to 72, this revelation took place. And then using this smaller, faster, more reliable computers are built, which where the cost is also started to reduce. Then using those IC, this microprocessor are built. So what is microprocessor? We are going to see in the next classes. Okay, now we are having, as I said, in a washing machine, you have this microprocessor. You should have seen when mechanic comes and open your washing machine or some devices in your system, even your laptop. You should have seen this with a green color. That is called as motherboard, and that we call it as a microprocessor. So many of you might have seen, even if when you open an old thing, which is not at all used, you can open it and you can see a green color chip, which is nothing but a microprocessor. Okay, so there are two types of computers. Now next comes after the microprocessor. With the microprocessor, they have started building the computers. Okay, so now, so first we will see what are the two types of computers. Basically, there are two types. One is analog computers and digital computers. So analog computers, it recognizes data as a continuous measurement of physical property. That is, you should have seen the sine wave. That is the wave which goes up and low. Okay, even the sound wave is an analog. Okay, so continuous measurement of a physical property. It has no state. And its output is usually displayed on a meter. You can measure the analog signals like this. Examples are analog clock. Where we have in our house, most of our house or home, we are having a clock which is nothing but analog clock. Where if you are having digital clock, if you have digital clock, time. Okay, time will change using that. I hope many of you can understand the difference between a digital clock and an analog clock. Still, many of us are having analog clocks where it ticks. There are two hands on that, long hand and short hand, and it rotates based on, and we have battery, or even we can give key so that it rotates. So it the clock works. Whereas we have digital clock. Even in watches, you have digital clock. That we call it as a digital clock. Okay. Then speedometer of a car and thermometer, etc. Digital computers. Now comes the, after that, now nobody cares about the analogs, right? Now we have only digital. It works with numbers, yes? Number crunching, computers are number crunching. They break all types of information into tiny units and use numbers to represent those pieces of information. Everything is described in two states, either an on and off. Even in your house, we have switches which have on and off. You want to switch on the fan means you on the switch. If you want to off, you off. There itself you have binary, 1 or 0. If it is 1, on. 0 means off. Like that, we can understand. So, and they are all very fast and have big memory. So, analog and digital signals. What is analog and digital signals? That we will see now. There are two basic types of electrical signals, namely analog and digital. The analog signals are continuous in nature and digital signals are discrete. What do you mean by discrete? You have 1 and 0, rise and fall. Whereas analog is a continuously rises and continuously fall. I'll show you what is that continuous fall. This is an example for analog signal. You can see here, see it continuously rises and continuously, then again grow, come like this. Whereas discrete means only rise, then again rise or falls. There itself, fall, rise, fall. So this is called, that is, you can say it as a digital signal. So after digitization, the continuous analog signal becomes, the same signals are digitized. You can see how it looks here with this one. Then here it rises like this. Okay, whereas analog is continuous. Okay, now with that, today I will close the session. It is 12:20. So let me close the session. Tomorrow we will see the continuity of this. What is meant by analog? 1 minute.